Hello all, this is Dr. Alsup, and in this video we will be discussing how to identify the structures associated with the carpal tunnel. So these are the same images, as you might can tell. This one is obviously zoomed in a bit, and these are both anterior views of the wrist region, as well as the hand and a bit of the forearm. And it makes sense that we're looking at an anterior view because the carpal tunnel is anteriorly placed. This area right here, this kind of opaque looking, is going to be it's opaque and white, and it's going to be a ligament. And to be more specific, it is the transverse carpal ligament, which is often referred to as the flexor retinaculum. This is the roof of the carpal tunnel, so the top of the carpal tunnel, and the contents are going to run deep to this ligament. And let me erase this right here so we can kind of get into some of those. All right, so the roof is going to be a ligament, that transverse carpal ligament, and then we need to figure out what is going on inside. So there is a lot going on in a pretty small region, and the majority of what is going on are tendons. So those long tendons from the anterior compartment of the forearm, so you can see them here in the forearm, they are traversing through this relatively small area. And these are those muscles that are going to have a distal attachment to the phalanges. These include the flexor digitorum superficialis, flexor digitorum profundus, and the flexor pollicis longus. So both of these here have four tendons each, and then there's one tendon associated with the flexor pollicis longus. Now, there are ways to tell, so all of these in this general region, these are tendons here, this is a tendon here. There's ways to tell the difference between, this is actually the ulnar nerve, so don't get confused, it's going over the carpal tunnel region. But there are ways to tell the difference between which tendon is which. But for our purposes, I just want you to understand which muscle tendons will traverse the tunnel, and don't worry so much about differentiating them. Not visible here are tendon sheaths, which are elongated bursae that surround the tendons. They often give the tendons a very glistening appearance, but are very, very delicate and often removed during any form of dissection. But as you know from the carpal tunnel learning objective, these tendon sheaths are very important in regards to carpal tunnel syndrome. They often become inflamed, and that's what often will cause compression of the one last thing we need to identify, which is the median nerve. So I'm going to outline. We can see the median nerve right here. So the median nerve is the nerve that's often compressed during carpal tunnel syndrome. Now the hard thing about the median nerve is that it's almost exactly the same size and not too far off in terms of color of the tendons, those tendons surrounding it. But it does tend to run superficial to the tendons and more laterally than most of them, not so much in terms of the flexor pollicis longus tendon, but it is generally more superficial. So usually it's distinguishable in that way. You can see it right here, the same median nerve as this one. You can also see this small cutaneous branch that is branching off proximal to the carpal tunnel. So right here, we know right here is the carpal tunnel because here's that roof, the transverse carpal ligament, and then this particular cutaneous branch branches off before or proximal. And this is why the skin, because this is a cutaneous branch, the skin over the thenar eminence and palm region won't be affected during carpal tunnel syndrome because this branch came off before the compression site within the carpal tunnel. All right, excellent. That is the carpal tunnel. A whole lot of tendons and that large median nerve as well. Please take time to review, and as always, please reach out with any questions.